Hi.
Hi.
Long time no see.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe.
Let's just catch up while we're doing the show, okay?
Okay, let's do it. Great idea.
Okay, well, welcome everybody to this week's episode of Squintcast. My name is Kelly.
And I'm Brittany.
And today we are going to eventually talk about Bones, season 3, episode 11, titled
The Player Under Pressure.
Which is actually season 2, episode 19. And this is going to be, we're going to talk a lot about season 2 here, yes. I think. And
you can tell this is a season 2 episode.
Honey, there's so many things, like, it's wow. Wow. And also very weird sex stuff. So
yes. But it buckle ties
up.
In.
Buckle up.
Season 2, buckle up.
First, we're going to talk about our Spotify Wrapped lists.
Yes.
Keep in mind that I am a huge Spotify user, and you are going to be basically telling me all of what Mark listens to.
Just, it's, this is literally just what Mark listens to. Also, do you want me to, this is loading. Do you want me to tell you about the writer and the director of this episode?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay, so that's loading. So the writer is a person named, no problem, Janet Tomorrow, who we mentioned in the last episode because she wrote the last episode, The Man in the Mud. And this is her final episode that she's written of Bones.
Okay.
So she did Aliens in a Spaceship.
Was it her first?
It could have been. Yeah, actually, wait. No, it would have been her second. Aliens in a Spaceship, season 2, episode 9.
Yes.
Player Under Pressure, originally season 2, episode 19.
Correct.
Now season 3, episode 11. And The Man in the Mud, season 3, episode 10. So we talked about her quite a bit last time. She is the writer, showrunner, and series creator of Rizzoli and Isles.
Yes.
She went on to do great things. Everything is wonderful. and on that note, everything is wonderful. Mm. Jessica Landau is the director of this episode.
Yes.
And interestingly enough, this was the only episode. No, that's not true. This is, she directed 2 episodes. The only episode this season that she directed, which the Player Under Pressure, which is the first episode ever that she directed of Bones.
Okay.
And then the next episode and the last episode she'll direct is season 4, episode 11, The Bone That Blew.
Season 4. Okay. Okay. I was trying
to just in and out
figure out this director's filmography.
It's interesting.
Don't seem to have done much since
lots of shorts.
2000s.
2012 was the last thing she did.
Yeah,
she's mainly an editor, it looks like.
Okay. Sometimes you'd have to, when there's going to be a writer strike, you got to get the editor to come in and direct, you know. It's just one of those things.
True.
Right?
That is very interesting. Yeah, and her Wikipedia page is extremely short.
Okay, but she's still with us, correct?
I think so. It doesn't say that she is no longer with us, but
I always wonder that, because if they stop working
at
this level, it's like, what happened? Either they died or they just went and had kids or something.
Or they like went on to do something completely random and
different. Oh, yeah, you never know. You never know.
Yeah. So I don't know. She does not seem to... She just kind of seems to have disappeared from Hollywood a little bit, but that's fine. Interesting. Moving on.
Moving
Do you want to talk about your
Wrapped? Moving on. Okay.
Wayne listened to 69 genres, by the way. How many did you listen to?
Oh, that's a good question, because I listened to 1,092 songs.
Okay.
How
do I get there? Oh, 1,991 songs was Mark.
I listened to 644 artists. I played this one song by Beastie Boys a lot. And I just want you to know that I have played my music at the gym. Like, people get me to play music at the gym all the time.
Oh, that's awesome.
And Beastie Boys shows up a lot. And this one is Shake Your Rump by the Beastie Boys. Have you heard of this song?
Shake Your Rump? I don't think I have. The Beastie Boys I've heard of, but Shake Your Rump. Maybe, though, you know I'm bad with names. Mark listened to 1,427 artists.
Wow.
But one came out on top.
Who's that?
The Tragically Hip. That actually surprises me.
Really?
I knew it would be up there, but I didn't expect it to be the one. This is awesome.
Wait for it.
What?
Gotta shake your
rump. What is that song called?
It's called Shake Your Rumpa.
Shake Your Rump.
Shake Your Rump by the Beastie Boys.
That's awesome.
Anyway, I'm not going to do this for the whole thing. I promise. I just thought it would be funny to play Shake Your Rump because apparently I play that the most.
That's your top song?
Top song. Number one, Beastie Boys.
So...
All right. It's not that I don't want to talk about this episode, but
there are some aspects of it that are meh.
Brittany, there are questions I have. There are things I need to know. I need to understand. There's stuff going on in this episode. I cannot abide.
No, it's definitely outdated. And then also, usually, because I watch the episodes multiple times, usually, like, the first time I watch the episode, I either remember it, and, like, as we're going through it, because I've seen all these episodes before, as I'm going through it, I'm like, oh, yeah, that's who the killer is.
Right.
This time, I couldn't remember. But then I watched it, and I was like, oh, okay, get it. And then I rewatched it, like, at least two more times. And I was watching throughout the episode, and in my opinion, there was no indication that this person was the murderer.
Nope. And we're going to talk about that, because there is a point in this episode when something happens, there's something going on, and I'm shaking my head going, knowing what I know now
about
how this ends up.
Yes.
I cannot believe that this is happening right now.
We know. Okay, we're talking about the same part for sure.
Are you sure? Are you sure?
Oh, 100%.
Okay, I'm confident. Let's figure out if we're talking about the same thing. Because I was like, they are wild for this. They are wild for this. Wild.
Oh, it's insane. Okay.
Wild. Okay.
Should we get started?
Yes, please. You start the show. We can be... We can be quick about it. I don't think we need to spend too much time on the details, but
no, yeah, I don't think we need much. And because of that, I think a lot of these scenes will go quickly.
Yeah.
We start with a typical season two episode dialogue between Brennan and Booth, where they're bickering at each other.
The shade. The
and
shade.
And Brennan is
all.
Correcting him. Mm-hmm. And Booth is like, I'm a jock. Why would you treat me like this? Anyway, but the whole idea is she's all shocked that there are so many people on campus because, they're going to a university gymnasium. That is where this victim died. So they're on campus at this university, and Brennan is shocked. She's walking with Booth because she doesn't like to drive separately. Where's her car? Who knows? But they're walking together, and she's like, wow, there are a lot of people on this campus. Because the year prior, she had given a speech on some topic we don't need to get into, something fancy, and only four people showed up to her talk. And the whole campus was dead because there was some huge basketball game across the country. So no one wanted to come to her talk. Everyone just wanted to go and watch sports. And she was like, oh, stupid. But Booth is like, yeah, of course. Why would anyone want to go to your talk when they could go and have beer and sex and watch basketball? Duh, Brennan. Anyway, that's how we start. From the get-go, I'm glad that we had this conversation before we delved into this episode.
Yeah.
Because, like, before we even watched it, because when I was watching it, I was like, yeah, this is season two. Very season two. Wow.
Very season two. It was crazy. What were we going to say?
There's no, like, sexual tension between them.
None.
Like,
none.
Zero.
None.
Which is very season three. So anyway, wild. Sorry, go on.
Where are we? Where'd you end up? I'm trying to remember.
So just now that we arrived. So they walk in. Yeah, we've arrived. We're now in the gymnasium.
And it seems that a student who opened the gym smelled something gross, called for help, and the campus police came. There's a guy there who's the chief of the campus police named Chief Cutler. We meet Justine, who's the one who opened the door, and they discovered some remains. Both Booth and Brennan venture behind the bleachers where these remains happen to be to inspect this sort of gloopy pile of disgusting stuff. It's like strained out of a sieve or something. Brennan identifies them as... What?
I was eating the first time I watched this episode. It was really gross. Anyway, go on. Sorry.
Brennan identifies the person as male. Booth asks Booth if he can smell quote unquote that. And he's like, you're kidding, right? And Brennan's like, not the decomp, you dumbass. The alcohol, like she can smell booze. Yeah. So Booth assumes that it's this vagrant who got caught under the bleachers. And then they accordion shut these retractable bleachers on him and he got squished through this grate. Then Booth gets so startled by the squeaking sound. And Brennan gets all excited because she finds this huge, unfrightened rat and picks it up by the tail. Subsequently, like, finds this litter of baby rats among the remains.
So many.
There were just, like, three or four little babies. There weren't that many.
No, there were more. I'm looking this up.
Look it
up,
and I'm going to keep talking.
Keep going. So,
Brennan wants to bag up these rodents as evidence, and Booth asks the campus policeman, Cutler, to grab some kind of receptacle to put the rats in. Brennan wants them to cut out the floor underneath the remains and part of the wall where the grate is, where the more of the remains have been pushed through. So that's an interesting thing, and it's kind of funny when you see it later, actually.
Yes.
So then, as this chief of the campus police comes over with this bag, Booth notices that he's wearing a ring, a 1982 championship ring from the university where they are, and Booth knows exactly who this guy is. Apparently, this Chief Cutler from the campus police was a star of the team in 1982 and was drafted by the Detroit Pistons. Cutler then... What?
So I'm just saying, oops, this guy was like... super important to the team and now he's dead.
No, Cutler is the chief of the campus police who offers the bag.
Oh, I'm totally to put no, the rats just cut that out. I'm trying to get to the
okay, Brittany.
Well, we're gonna get there.
I'll tell you when we get there, okay?
Yeah, okay.
Please. Anyway, so Cutler seems like a major depressive. This guy's like super depressed because he didn't make it to the Pistons because he fucked up his knees. Anyway, Booth is chatting up this Cutler dude. Brennan finds a huge gold chain enveloped in the victim's remains that has a pendant with the number 11 on it. Then Booth and Cutler know exactly who this person is. Turns out it's this dude, RJ Manning, who is a star player on this university basketball team.
As previously spoiled by Brittany.
Here's my question. I'm going to tell you something. I grew up in a town with a university called Mount Allison University. University back in the 80s had some great athletes, really great athletes. We had great teams, hockey team, basketball team, swim team. We had great, great athletes, okay? And I had huge crushes on a lot of them because they were like handsome and like they were very athletic and
of course
very serious. I love
makes
them.
Sense.
Ask me one of their names right now.
Who was one of, what was one of their names?
Honey, I have no fucking clue. Like, I don't know anything about these people because you know what? You know what? We're talking like, okay, Booth's saying this guy was 1982. It's now 2007. How many years is that, for God's sake?
Yeah, that's 20, a long time.
25 years?
But I justified because Booth is a betting man. That maybe he was betting on these.
Oh, a gambler.
Games.
Interesting. Yeah.
That I thought that as well. And then I reasoned with myself. I just turned my internet off on my phone so that I could.
It was she's not still, loading. I'm just going to let everybody know that Brittany this whole time has been looking for the number of baby rats.
You're totally right. I was so sure. There's only three of them.
There's only tiny little babies.
I they're thought like... for sure. Oh, I'm trying to show you.
Look, you don't have to show me. You're preaching to the converted. I know there's three or four of them for sure.
I thought there were so many more. Okay, anyway. I'm going to just grow now. Go on.
During all this, Brennan it does not give a shit about any of this stuff. She thinks it's ridiculous. Yeah. And the way she says it too, like when Booth starts rhyming off this guy's statistics and all this, and Brennan's like, well, it's not going to do him any good now. He's a little bit dead. Like, he's not going to make it to the NBA now.
And he didn't even have to ruin his knees. Like, he just fell and died.
Anyway, and then we have.
Oh my God.
Our intro.
Our intro.
Bum 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 bum. I don't know what that is that you're singing every time.
I don't know either. Honestly, I sing a lot now. Like I love to sing.
Me? I love to sing.
I love to sing. So I love to sing, but I don't do it that often, except that with Wayne. Wayne is he loves to sing and he loves to dance. But like at the level of a toddler, but still. So like I'm constantly singing with him now, like Jingle Bells, We Wish You Merry Christmas, like,
oh my God.
Anyway, I'm basically a toddler performer over here, so.
Right.
I don't get paid for it, but you know.
How's his tone? Can he hold a note? Like, what's going on?
He can, which is like wild. Like he sings a song and you know it's the song. Even if he's not saying like exactly the right words, but sometimes he'll kind of like mumble like parts he doesn't know. He'll like mumble them, but he's like, he has the tune, which is really cool.
I had a client, she had this kid and her kid was like an actress. She was born like to perform. And she's like this little redheaded girl. She's like, Mah! She's like constantly performing.
So cute.
And her mother, the client, was like a trained opera singer, and it drove her insane. It drove her insane to listen to her kids sing because it was so off key. It would drive her nuts, right? And she'd roll her eyes all the time, like, oh God, here she goes again. Like, but she never, like, she always encouraged her, but she just,
yeah, like, oh, but behind her back, she'd be like,
Anyway, fast forward to today, the kid is like performing in musicals in Toronto and everything. She's in like the Mergish production, the pantomime that's going on this Christmas. She's already been on TV. Oh, no, she's a little actress now. She was born to do it. She's like one of those kids that just wants to be a performer. And it's just like, wow. She's in it.
Followed her dream. Well, yeah, she had parents too that supported her. Like her mom, support even. And she was in that world too, which is awesome.
Well, that's the thing. Like, her mother was like, you know what? If she's going to do all this singing, I'm going to get her some lessons because I cannot.
Yeah.
I can't do this. And it's so funny because my mother was a mezzo soprano herself. She was a singer and she hated it when I sang. She hated it.
What?
And she would tell me, you can't sing your way out of a paper bag. She always told me that. You can't sing your way out of a paper bag, Kelly. I'd be like, okay. Anyway. La la la
la la. Bitch, please. You are a great singer.
Oh, but I mean, she's like,
respectfully, but still.
Doesn't matter anymore. It's okay.
But bitch, please.
Bitch,
no, you have a great voice. I love to hear you
sing.
It's
like, I'll get her ashes and sing. Sing at her all the
all
time.
Day.
I like
all
that.
What do you think of that one?
Nightmare. Back of the lab.
Okay, so we're back in the lab. We're trying to figure out if this person, this victim, was murdered. Or if they just suffered a very unfortunate accident. We learned something very interesting, I think. And that is the difference between powdering and crushing, basically. So if there's powdering, then if on the bones there's powdering, then that would indicate that they were, that there's blunt force trauma, BFT.
BFT.
And, BFT. And then if it's just like multiple breaks and whatever, then it would just be like, okay, yeah, the bleachers crush this person and that's too bad. This skull does show evidence of powdering, which leads them to believe their current working theory, until they can prove otherwise, is that RJ Manning was murdered.
But Hodgins is kind of arguing that, like trying to challenge Zach on this theory a little bit. And then Hodgins starts lamenting the loss of this player and how the team is going to really notice the loss. And I'm like, okay, never mind this guy's friends and family, like his family and friends. Nobody gives a shit about his family. They all want to talk about how the team, the team. And then Zach, the wunderkind, starts talking about RJ's stats. So this is back in the day when Zach was a basketball fan, I guess. Remember?
Yeah.
At the end of season one, wasn't it?
Yes.
Where he was like this basketball dude.
Yeah.
Anyway, sometimes he likes basketball. Sometimes he doesn't. He knows and doesn't know.
But Zach in this episode, again, sorry to bring up season two versus season three again, but
that's what we're going to do the whole time.
He is like, this is definitely filmed in season two, because in season three, he's freaking weird. Like, he's very antisocial. He's very full of himself. Doesn't want to listen to people. Is not friendly. But here he's got this kind of weird camaraderie with Hodgins again. And they kind of... Cam doesn't have that same authority over them yet. There's been a lot of character development since season two. So we've kind of jumped back in time a little bit, which is interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think they're going to try to, Brennan gives Zach the job to classify the skull fractures, which means that he's going to have to recreate the skull, which is his fave. He loves to do that. And Hodgins gets to look at the victim's clothing.
But we need to mention, this is interesting, this little interaction between Hodgins and Brennan, because Brennan tells Zach to put the skull back together. Like, we all know the skull went through a grate, so it's in tiny little pieces, and he has to.
Oh, yeah.
And so Hodgins makes a joke about Zach going to be there all weekend, like gluing those little pieces of skull back together. And then Brennan snaps back at him and goes, well, actually, this is going to keep you pretty busy, Hodgins, like looking at all the detritus and stuff, right? So, and he was like, somewhat humbled.
For sure.
Not enough, in my opinion. Plus, that Hodgins's hair is a clear indicator of what season this is.
Yes. Also, his attitude. He's in season two, I found him to be very full of himself, very annoying. Awful. Season three, his character is much more palatable. So,
really, you think Zach, so?
Yes. And season three, I just want it on the record that Kelly loves Hodgins in season three.
No, and, that's not true. He has had moments where I have tolerated him and that he's shown some potential of being less of an insane, creepy, gross person. And then I remember all
every
the
so
things.
Often.
Just and, like nope.
And this is this episode is a big reminder of his creepiness, which is unfortunate.
So gross.
Speaking of RJ's family, yes. He does have family. He has a sister and a brother, two sisters. I said yes. Sister and a brother, and I was like, wait a second. So anyway, so his two sisters are there, and we get some information that their parents have passed away, which is quite unfortunate. But in their parents' place, they have this very helpful guy, this mentor who was a huge mentor to RJ, named Mr. Francis.
Mm-hmm.
And so Mr. Francis has taken it upon himself to come to this meeting with the two sisters. And they can hardly believe that their brother is dead. They're like, well, maybe someone else is wearing his medallion. Are you sure you have him? And it's like, okay, it's been like a long time, like quite a few days. You would think you would have heard from your brother by now. Like, I get that they would not want him to be dead, but anyway. So they don't really have much to help them with other than to point them in the direction of RJ's girlfriend, who is a cheerleader for the same university. And so yeah, they're gonna go and talk to the cheerleader, his girlfriend. They're gonna go talk to his coach as well, because he was big into basketball. The coach would have been the other person that he would have been spending a lot of time with.
Right.
But the sisters themselves weren't that helpful I didn't find them. They were grieving.
Well, they were given very short shrift. The family's barely acknowledged in this whole situation. I just thought
yeah.
Very, 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 very strange.
Definitely.
So next we're back at the lab.
Back at the lab.
And we have Hodgins. And he's going to conduct an experiment.
Very season
he's
two.
He's in his special experiment room / office, wrapping a turkey around a fake skull. Cam walks in while he's doing this, and he and Zach are trading barbs at each other. They're bickering. And the plan is to push this turkey-covered skull through a grate to see how it affects the skull and try to determine whether that was how RJ was killed, to sort of eliminate that as one of the methods.
Yeah.
Hodgins has also mentioned something that he's put some kind of substance, a gelatinous substance, in the skull to emulate brain matter. Okay?
Yeah.
So they begin the experiment, and everyone's wearing safety goggles. Okay. I'm just going to mention, like, okay, that's all they're wearing is safety goggles. And they're standing literally maybe a foot, 2 feet away from the grate that they're going to push us through. They push the turkey through the grate, and the thing friggin' explodes everywhere. And the quote unquote brain matter is all over the place. And Cam tastes it, and it's made of ambrosia salad.
Why she would taste it when it came from a raw turkey.
Also, the raw turkey is a problem. I have a real problem with the raw turkey situation because, like, there has to be pieces of raw turkey flying around there, too.
Ugh,
This whole thing is just meant to be absolutely disgusting. Regardless, Zach determines, based on that experiment, there's no powdering, as we discussed earlier,
yeah,
from the experiment. Therefore, RJ was struck in the head. Therefore, he was murdered.
Yeah.
And then we move to a scene, I think, that's happening simultaneously as this experiment. Where do we go, yeah, Brittany?
Then we're going to have a little bit of a car conversation, which Booth and Brennan, do they have a lot of car conversations in season three? I think they still kind of do, but
season
I feel like
three,
this is
they're
like
always in the car. Are you kidding me? They were in the car so much, like, I think in the last episode. They drive all the time.
I
feel like
season two, I guess this started in season two. They are always in the car. I'm really grasping at straws here.
You really are. This is not a season two thing. Season two comes up later.
Fine. Okay, anyway, so they're thinking that Booth and Brennan are on different pages in terms of how important this RJ Manning guy is. Because Booth is like, okay, there's actually millions of dollars at stake here. And Brennan's like, okay, what are you talking about? So he thinks that there could have been possibly something going on with this guy being like a super famous dude. And maybe someone would want to kill him for that with all the money at stake and other things. Anyway, so they have proved that. We find out at this moment, which is why you're saying that it was at the same time, but we find out that, in fact, RJ was murdered. So, anyway, it's kind of, if I found it, it was kind of like a filler scene, but they basically are just bickering again.
They're talking about, Booth explains to her that he was a college athlete himself. And my question was to you, was he? I don't remember him ever talking about being an athlete in college. He's never talked about this before. And this is our conflict. Army? How young was he when he joined the army? Exactly.
Yeah.
A, B. This is a guy who's like 38, 39, maybe 40 tops at this point. And he's been to the army. He's been a policeman. He's an FBI agent. Like, I don't know about this whole college career. Anyway.
Yeah.
The whole point of this is the setting up Brennan and Booth having this conflict about their, you know, how they view sports and as a spectator, as an athlete, and she doesn't get it. Brennan is being particularly obtuse in this situation, and she continues to be obtuse about it. I understand her argument about, like, why do these people get paid millions of dollars to bounce a ball?
Yeah.
And then she doesn't understand why people watch it, and Booth says it's about, you know, escaping yourself, being outside of yourself. And she compares it to drinking and drugging, basically, like getting drunk and using drugs, watching sports because you're escaping from yourself. Anyway.
Yeah.
I just...
Yeah, you did a much better job of that. That was a perfect summary of the scene.
It's just this argument they're having about the sports. It's just like, okay.
Well, and it doesn't get better.
No, it doesn't. Because
we just go straight to the gym. And we go straight to the gym. There's a bunch of cheerleaders sitting on the benches. Is this the same gym that RJ Manning was murdered in?
Okay.
Just a question.
Okay. I know you're going to talk about this, but this is so crazy to me. Because they get to the gym. They want to talk to the coach. The coach is like, you know, boom, like talking to the
giving
players.
An inspirational speech.
Yeah, but like basically he's like, you know, suck it up, you know, we're going to get together. We're
no
gonna
tears.
Be stronger. No tears. I'm just like, okay. And like, I'm sorry, but Booth and Brennan arrive there to talk to this coach. And he basically says like, oh, you better interview these players quick because, you know, I want them to move on. Why does everybody, that is so season two, like wanting everybody to move on, hurry up and move on.
Hurry up and just get over it.
This gym, is this the same gym? Like you said, shouldn't
it's
this
the same
be
gym?
If this
a
is
crime
a
scene,
but it's a murder. They should have it taped off and there should be like canvassing the whole school.
You
shut
would
it
think
down.
So.
Shut it down.
Basketball practice has to go on. And not just basketball practice. The cheerleaders must cheer. They got to practice their cheerleading.
Question.
And is this a religious school? Okay, anyway, go on. Yes.
I have a question about cheerleading just quickly. And we're going to bring this up a couple times as I'm not a person who's a cheerleader. Did you have a cheerleading team in your high school? A,
B? I went to an all-girls school, so no.
No. So do they wear their cheer uniforms when they practice is my question.
Probably.
No, there's no way. Have you not seen the Netflix show Cheer? Have you not seen that show?
No.
Brittany, you would love Cheer.
I probably would.
It's amazing.
I really would. I know exactly what it's about.
It's just about cheer squads, but they don't wear their uniforms when they're. That's for show day. That's for game day.
Well, these girls do in this.
Oh, they wear them a lot. Just in case you didn't know, they were cheerleaders, everybody.
God. They can't just be wearing regular clothes.
God, no, I wouldn't know who they were.
So they're all in their cheer uniforms. Sorry. And suddenly, and the coach is all, so Booth and Brennan are watching on as this like unbelievable situation unfolds with this very famous actor, by the way. He was in Chicago Fire. He was once engaged to Lady Gaga. His name
is... What are you talking about?
One of the basketball players. What is his name? Sorry, one second.
What basketball players? We're talking to the cheerleaders now, aren't we?
No, the basketball players were there.
I thought they went away though. Like the coach dismissed them.
Yeah, I want to tell you what his name was.
While you look that up.
Yes.
All the basketball players get dismissed to go like remember their friend and then come back serious the next day.
After they give an out loud prayer.
Apparently there's a famous person in the basketball team. And then Booth and Brennan go. Oh yeah, go on.
Taylor Kinney.
Taylor Kinney. K E or K I?
K I N N E Y.
Kinney.
He is a smoke show.
Is he?
Oh yeah. In my opinion.
Oh. Okay. Interesting.
He's hot.
He's so hot.
He's so hot.
Okay. So the basketball players go away. Sorry. Booth and Brennan are there. Brennan's like, what do we do now? Then friggin' Booth goes, well, we got to find out which one of these cheerleaders is RJ's girlfriend.
Which one of these pretty girls?
Yeah, but wouldn't they already know this information by now?
You would think so.
He's in the FBI, Brittany.
Yes.
FBI.
And also they know her name. They already told the sisters said her name was Dallas Verona. They said that in the last scene.
I didn't write down her name once. I didn't know what her name was.
She's a cheerleader named Dallas.
That's insane.
Yeah. Anyway, this girl. Oh boy. So she's in the interrogation room with Booth and Brennan at the FBI. She's there by herself, which is interesting. Because I don't know how old she would actually be. But I guess old enough to go by herself, but that's fine.
Brittany.
We're moving on.
Don't even get me started on that shit. But the lawyer situation. Then they have
this awkward. Oh, yeah. They have this awkward conversation with her, like asking her if she was sexually active. And she's like, obviously, he was like really hot and like in such good shape. So obviously we boned all the time. Like, give me a break. It was just every day except for game day, obviously. Anyway, she was like, she was so annoying.
You didn't like her?
No, I found her so annoying.
Oh, I liked her. I thought she was great.
Oh, we have different opinions on this, especially. Yeah, we're gonna come back to this later.
I liked her a lot because she was very like she wasn't stupid. I liked her.
Yeah. Well,
go on.
RJ was apparently very stressed out. He always wanted to win. He was worried about his midterms. And he had hit Mr. Francis, which is an important point. She didn't know why, but she does know that he did it and he felt really bad about it. So probably that's the next person that we need to talk about because she didn't know before this scene either that they thought RG was murdered.
Right.
There was talk that there was speculation they thought that, but now they tell her like officially, yeah, he was murdered.
No, they didn't tell her. She figured it out based on the line of questioning.
She's like, oh, they think, like, Mr. Francis is right that you think RG was murdered. Meh. I find her annoying.
She didn't sound like that at all, Brittany. You're so funny. She was very confident and calm, and I liked her a lot. I liked her. You're making her sound like a whiny little baby. You hated her.
My opinion of her changed so much later. I think maybe that's why.
I thought she was she knew what she wanted. I like that.
True. Okay. Oh my God.
I'm going to make you come around. Scene. I will never like Hodges, but I'm going to make you change your mind about this one.
But Dallas will both like
Dallas, I'm going to make you love her.
Do you want to talk about this next scene? This is such a season two scene. Oh my
God. This is like the most ridiculous cartoon scene I've ever seen in my life. We're back at the lab. We have Hodgins. And he's excited because, like, he couldn't find any shit on the body, but he found all these maggots that have all the toxins in them. So he's got these wiggling, gross maggots. I hate maggots. Maggots gross me out so hard.
Oh, they're disgusting.
There's something, like, so, like, it makes me, like, right now, I'm like, gets my back up. Like, it makes me, like,
it's like so me and cotton balls. Yes.
What?
Oh, yeah, I have, like, I can't touch cotton balls.
No!
Yeah.
Are you like that lady in the Jerry Springer show where they bring out the person wearing cotton balls?
No.
You ever see that?
I have to, yes.
Did you ever see that?
I've seen that.
Oh, my God!
It's, if I had to touch, like, I have only thrown out one piece of Wayne's art. I've actually kept it all from daycare.
Because it was all made of cotton balls? Insane.
But there was a cloud that he made out of cotton balls, and I was like, I can't. No, this is, it's beautiful, but it's garbage.
That is so funny, Brittany.
Anyway,
wild
maggots, wild. Cotton balls, same. Go on.
Anyway, maggots in a beaker, whatever. So he has to take these maggots for some reason and put them in a blender. And he's talking to Cam while he's doing this, and Cam is watching him do this. And as she sees him dump the maggots into this blender, she looks at the blender and she's like, Is that my blender? And then he starts blending up the maggots. And he just keeps going, talking about the maggots and the toxins. And she's like, no, is that my blender? Where did you get that blender? And he's like, maggots, blah, blah, blah. And she's like, hey, did you get this blender out of the kitchen? Is this my personal blender? Like, and she asked him to check the bottom for her initials. And it says, you know, property of Cam, whatever, SES, whatever. And he goes, yeah, actually, that's what it says. So it's her personal blender from the kitchen. And she's like looking at him mortified. She's mortified that he's blending up these maggots. And he goes, don't worry about it. I'll rinse it out. And Cam's face, this is, I think, if this is season two, this is the beginning of her face and how she has to deal with these people, right? Like, we've been talking a lot about her face and how she reacts to their absolute, like, it, like the way they act, she just, the way she reacts to them is just, but this face is classic Cam.
I feel like season three, though, she would have shut that down, like, while it was happening. She would have been like, no, listen to me, Hodgins. Is that my blender? Like, she wouldn't have let him ignore her. So anyway, we go back to this gym where possibly RJ Manning died, but everyone's hanging out. I don't know. Anyway, it's just the two of them, Booth and Brennan, and they're continuing their bickering. Because quite frankly, Brennan, like you said, she's being very obtuse about this whole sports situation. She's telling Booth that the only reason anthropologically that boys even play sports or men even play sports was initially it was like we gotta prep for our battle, like we gotta prep for battle, hone our battle skills, but instead obviously they don't need to do that anymore, so it's just a way for boys and men to continue to be boys and act childish. So anyway, he's not having any of that. They're standing at a basketball net. He's showing her how to shoot a ball. It's fine. She's being very rude about it. Then he gets very sick of her. And he just... You're pulling up the cotton ball lady. eventually he just gets sick of her. And is like, you know what? I'm a jaw. It just cut out.
She's running away from the cotton ball mountain. She ran away from the cotton balls.
I don't blame her. Just like how Booth ran away from Brennan because she was being mean to him.
Yeah.
Look at that segue. So, and we find out that his shoulder crapped out on him. And that's the only reason that he wasn't an NBA basketball player. Otherwise, he would have gone all the way.
There's like, no way he would have gone all the way. He's too short. 5'11" Too big. Yes. Too short, too big. There's no way he would have gone all the way. He takes this so personally. It's absolutely so crazy. I'm sorry I interrupted with the cotton ball lady.
No, it's fine. Really
funny.
It's hilarious. Mark likes to, when he sees cotton balls, he's like, ooh. Like opening like a thing of Advil.
Oh my God. Does he wake you up? Does he go over you sleeping and touch your face with cotton balls?
Don't encourage him.
Oh, I might have to send him a little note.
I got this from my dad. This is something my dad did growing up. And I like thought it was, I was like, no, I'll never do that. And then as I got older, I was like, ugh.
Oh my God. Anyway, it's like genetic. I have a friend. You can't say the word button. She gets
what?
She freaks out. Like the word button. She can't stand it.
I thought you were gonna say she like moist.
No, moist.
You can't
is
hear
dumb.
The word moist. Moist.
Anyway. Button. So stupid. Okay.
Button. Hopefully she doesn't listen to our podcast. Button.
Button,
okay,
button.
Anyway, so he walks button. Off and she's like, okay, well, he's ridiculous, so I'm just gonna stand here and you know what, I'm gonna shoot this hoop. And she gets it in and it's quite beautiful,
and then she's very proud of herself.
She's so excited about it.
Well, here's the thing, and it proves right in that moment the sense of accomplishment, and that's why people do sports.
Yeah, okay, exactly. She kind of proves to herself why people play sports.
You're talking to somebody who goes to the gym 5 or 6 days a week, so
yes,
converted over here. Converted.
You like sports.
Okay, so then,
do you know the song I like sports and I don't care who knows? Anyway, go on.
Well, who sings that?
Lonely Island.
Oh.
It's a parody. I like sports and I don't care who knows.
Oh my God.
I'm very giddy. Okay, go on.
Okay.
Sorry.
So Brennan does her shoots her shot at the basket, gets it in, very proud of herself, runs out after Booth. He's running outside to meet up with this dude, Colby, who is the guy, the player who's taking over the victim's position on the basketball team. Brennan catches up to Booth and Booth yells out, yo, to Colby to stop him. And Brennan recoils at his use of the word yo. And he goes, you know what? Basically tells Brennan to shut the fuck up and leave him alone. He's irritated. And he just needs some space to get over it. And Brennan doesn't get over, like, Brennan doesn't get it. And he says, listen, Brennan, listen, Bones, I really like sports, you know, just leave me alone. So then we meet Colby and his girlfriend, Celeste. Brennan and Booth are coming in hot with the whole, must be nice to be a starter. Must be nice. You took RJ's shot. Must be nice. Must be nice. And
must be nice that you murdered him because you wanted his spot.
Yeah. And then Celeste, his girlfriend, sticks up for him immediately. Colby introduces her to Booth and Brennan as Celeste Cutler, who happens to be the daughter of Chief Cutler, the campus policeman. Boop-a-doo. And then,
shocker.
What'd you say?
It's a shocker.
Oh, what a shocker. So Booth reasons with Celeste, saying how she must understand because her father's in law enforcement that he has to ask these questions. And then Brennan goes, yeah. And your boyfriend benefits directly, you know, from RJ's death. And then this is okay. I'm just going to go off here because Celeste goes, well, I don't like her. I don't like her. Get her away from me. Like she's like, doesn't like Brennan because Brennan was being up front.
She's such a drama queen, this girl.
I'm like, why does Brennan get so much hate? Because people do this to Brennan all the time. They go, oh, I don't like her. I don't like her. Who is this? Like, I don't like her.
Yeah.
And is it because she's a woman? And like, if it was Booth asking the question, would they act the same way? I wonder, you know?
That's a good point. I also feel like that's not real life. Like, even if you don't like someone, you don't say to their face, I don't like her.
You also like, don't
get
say
away from me
in front of an FBI agent. Oh. And the scientist who's investigating a case of a guy that .. Okay?
Yeah.
..
Well, also, Colby is like, okay, Celeste, you're being a drama queen.
I know. Yeah.
You know what? Why don't you just go and I'll handle this? And then he apologizes for her because she's really, really loyal. And we're just going to come back to that later.
Dot, dot, dot.
Dot. Also, sorry, so, this is off topic, but I sent Mark a text of a ton of dot, dot, dots because like an hour ago or like 30 minutes before we got on our call.
Yeah.
Because I went to go, like I make his yogurt and I like pack the lunches, whatever, every night.
What a good wife.
I'm such a good wife. And I see on the fridge, there's this business card. Well, Mark does all the cooking, so I really am just cleaning up the dishes. And I just happened to put the food into containers. But so there's a business card for his dentist on there. And the date of his next dentist appointment is February 29th, 2024 at 5:30 p.m.
Oh,
which is my anniversary.
At what time?
At 5:30 p.m.
Oh, fuck off, dentist.
I sent it to Mark. I was like, I don't think you realized what day she put on this. And then he just texted me back. He's like, oh, shit. He was like, oh, I thought you would be so proud that I booked my appointment in advance.
Oh, my God. Not on that day. It's like you only get one anniversary every 4 years. God.
Anyway, so I just sent dot, dot, dot to him. And the picture of the appointment, I'm like, do you think maybe this is a problem?
Oh my God.
Anyway, I thought it was funny.
Where are we?
So, okay. So, sorry. So now we're talking to Colby alone without Celeste in the room, in the space. It was outdoors. Anyway. And yeah, he's saying, listen, I was just home when at the time that RJ was killed. I'm not replacing him just because I'm taking his position over. Like, you gotta cut me some slack here. Like, I didn't murder this guy. And it sounds like he actually can't verify his alibi because he was just hanging out alone. So now he, instead of lawyering up, he says that he won't say anything until he speaks with Mr. Francis.
Right.
I don't know. This Mr. Francis just keeps coming back again and again.
Yeah.
And it's very interesting to see what relationships he has with each of these players and family members. So
exactly.
Anyway.
But the thing I loved about Colby is that he talks to them about this, all this stuff, and says, I'm not going to talk to you anymore. And then he apologizes. He goes, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I just can't. Mm-hmm. So he's like, not rude. Not at all. He's just like, you know, I can't do this right now. He was like the most polite of everybody in this whole thing.
He was wonderful. I really liked his character. And and when we talked to him a little bit, when we talked to him a little bit later as well, like you kind of get even more of a feel for him. He didn't have any intention of taking over RJ Manning's position. Like, to me, it seemed very obvious at this point. I was like, I don't think this guy murdered RJ Manning. He's a team player. He never wanted to be a star. He said it himself, like, killing RJ Manning was not going to help him achieve something. So,
yeah.
Anyway, very interesting. Turns out we're back at the lab with Cam and Angela.
Oh, God.
And Cam is actually looking for Hodgins. And so she walks into Angela's office and, finds Angela, which is wonderful, except that very unprofessionally, she passes off the file that she wanted Hodgins to have with Angela and gives kind of a rundown, like, okay, let him know that the tox screen came back negative for alcohol and sedatives, despite the body reeking like booze. Someone just poured alcohol on him. More interestingly, he was on steroids. Very interesting. And there was some extra synovial fluid in his joints, which I don't know. We'll find out if that's a problem. But okay. So those are the three big things. Cam goes to walk away and is like, okay, you got this. Angela's like, I don't know. Like, I'll try. It just is very awkward.
Listen.
Yes. It's totally unprofessional, right?
This is so weird.
It's so weird. Up.
I have many issues with it, especially because of what happens later.
Yes.
Basically, Cam is asking Angela to do something for her, for Hodgins. My first question, Hodgins has his own office. Why can't she leave that file in Hodgins' office?
Because she has an ulterior motive, I think.
I think so. This is a very, it turns out.
Very passive
aggressive. I'll talk about it. Well, I was going to say that, but I was trying not to spoil it too much because what happens later is pretty major. Yeah. And I find this so cunty and passive aggressive and like really weird. And
yeah,
I don't know why this is happening. At the time, I didn't understand why this is happening. Mm-hmm. And Cam is really pushing Angela to give Hodgins all this information. And it's just like, Angela's acting like a dummy.
Yeah.
First of all. And really resistant and really bitchy towards Cam, who is her boss. I'm just going to remind everybody in this episode, being season two, that everybody is treating Cam like with this level of disrespect that I just cannot abide.
But that's what's so interesting. That is very season two. Because by season three, this disrespect is not there.
Right.
So I wanted to look at, sorry, while we were chatting.
Yes.
I wanted to look at what episode Angela and Hodgins get engaged.
Yes, because it wasn't until the end.
I thought so.
Because then they got married, they're going to get married the next week, remember? Because he did the shrimp thing. Anyway, I was curious because Cam mentions that they live together and it's a very odd, because of where they've placed this episode, it's a very strange situation. And I want to talk to somebody about why it's here. Why is this episode here?
Yeah, it's weird that they moved it. I wonder if it's because of the writer's strike, like the timing.
But why didn't they air it then?
Pending? I don't know. I also... Okay. They got engaged, I think.
It's a shrimp
season
day.
2, episode 20.
Yeah.
After but this. What's interesting, she's wearing an engagement ring in this episode.
Is she?
She is. I was looking for it. In this scene, she's wearing an engagement ring.
Oh.
That's what's interesting to me. So I wonder if they went back and re-knowing that they were going to move the episodes.
Okay.
If they went back and like re-recorded, that's not the right thing.
You're on to something here. Maybe refilmed. They put these scenes because they are so out of place in the episode.
They're so out of place. It's so awkward.
I want to know if they put, you might be right. They might have filmed those scenes and cut them in.
Yeah.
But what's the point?
Well, I don't know. I really don't know. But I thought based on the timing of when it was filmed, I was like, okay, this is weird because she wouldn't be wearing an engagement ring. But she was. And I was like, huh, interesting.
Okay. Anyway. We'll talk about this more later because it's
we have lots to talk about. Okay. Now where are we? We go to talk. Well, Booth goes to talk to the coach. And it's weird. I don't really know why this is happening, but the coach is up in his office, which overlooks the basketball court. And he's up there watching practice. Which maybe that's because he knew that Booth had to have this interview with him. I don't know. So they're up in this viewing area.
No, coaches don't have to be there all the time.
I guess so. Okay, so they're up in this viewing area. And Booth is chatting with him. And Booth is not beating around the bush at all. He's telling him, okay, the talk screen for RJ Manning came back positive. Like... There's lots of reasons that you would have, came back positive for steroids. There are many, many reasons that you would have wanted to push steroids on him because it looks really good on you if your player makes the NBA and you get a huge bonus because of that and you have all these incentives. And this coach cuts him off immediately and points behind his ear and makes him aware that because of his steroid use, he now has terminal cancer. So terminal brain cancer because of his steroid use. So in no way, shape, or form would he have encouraged steroids because it's killing him. Within 2 years, he's expected to pass. And he has a zero, because of his own issues from the past, he has a zero steroid tolerance policy. So if he were to find out that any person is using steroids, they would be immediately kicked off the team. He just wants them to win. He wants them to win, but he wants them to win cleanly. And he doesn't want them to get hurt. So he says, Booth says, listen, I'm going to have to pursue the steroid thing. I understand you're not involved, whatever, but I need to figure out what's going on. And yeah, the coach gives him full reins and says, listen, you don't need a warrant. You can get urine samples from every one of these kids. If they don't want to give you a sample, they're off the team. I don't care.
There's no way that this would be allowed. I think that parents would not, like, there's got to be a rich parent somewhere that's being like, you're not doing that. Don't you dare give them anything. Like, there's, you know,
they would all lawyer up.
There's no advocacy. It's very, very strange.
No.
And I didn't know that you could get brain cancer from steroids. That was an interesting
thing. I didn't know that either.
I had no
idea. Steroids are really bad for you.
Oh my God, it's so bad.
Reasons, obviously.
Excuse me. But
anyway, most interesting. It's a nice, it's like a weird, nice little break from, like, to me, this scene, it was just like this nice little aside from the rest of the episode that was important to the rest of the episode, but their conversation, I like the scene. I can't explain why.
It was pretty crazy,
welcome
though.
Welcome edition. Yeah.
It was crazy that he was like, immediately, I have brain cancer. I'm going to die. I'm not interested in the money. I don't want to move up to the NBA as a coach. Yeah. This is it. Don't tell anybody, but there's no way I would allow this to go on.
Take my player's pee, and if they don't want to give it to you, then they're off the team.
Exactly.
Just go do your thing.
Geoblast.
So they did. No, not one of the players put up a fight, it would appear, because in the next scene, Cam and Brennan are already talking about the samples, and none of the samples show steroid use. However, two of the samples came back positive for a drug that's known to treat gonorrhea, which would explain the extra synovial fluid that we talked about in RJ's joints. So it would appear that he had gonorrhea when he died, and two members of the team also had gonorrhea when he died. So that's not, or still, they still have it. Not necessarily. Well, they probably had it when he died, but also now. So the other thing is there are two urine samples that came back with identical levels of antibiotic.
Yeah.
So one player is protecting another. So there actually probably is a player that's using steroids, but one of the players with gonorrhea gave a double sample.
Yes.
So, anyway, very interesting.
Sometimes, I don't know, man. The way the places Kinney this
comes in next.
Yes, your friend Taylor comes in. He's not a nice guy. Anyway, next, Booth is interrogating two of the players from the basketball team. And Booth tells them one of them is taking steroids. The other one's being treated for the clap. I love how they call gonorrhea the clap. It's just so funny. Both players screw up their stories. Like, kind of screw up and kind of tell on themselves.
So dumb.
This one particular dude comes the one pretty with the clean clap. About the clap, because he doesn't really care. Like, he just had to get an antibiotic shot in the ass. He doesn't give a shit. And his friend who's taking steroids is like, fuck you, man. Like, you're supposed to cover for me. But, like, you know, when it comes to murder, maybe not. Okay, guys?
No.
Like, let it go.
You're not that close.
Anyway, Booth tells the guy with gonorrhea to leave. And the other guy's really pissed. He's like, why does he get to go? Because you're an idiot. So here's Booth's theory. I love this. This is another season 2 thing where they always have these theories and they approach people who are possible suspects, and they start like immediately downloading this theory onto them about how they killed this person. I'm just like, is that a season three thing too, or is it just me? Like,
I feel like it's evolved.
I know they bounce around ideas and they discuss theories when they're driving or at the lab or something, but I don't see them doing this a lot in season three where they're like directly going to these suspects and saying, you did it because blah, blah, blah.
They have to be like, no, just what are you talking about?
They have these theories, but anyway, I mean, who am I to say? I mean, the motorcycle racing one, they were throwing theories around all over the place regardless. So
that's so true. That was just last episode.
Yeah, I know. At the end of the day, this player that is taking steroids adamantly denies killing RJ because RJ made him look really good. And like he could have gone to the European leagues or maybe even the NBA, given how much they collaborated on the court and stuff.
Yeah.
So now Booth wants to know where he's getting these steroids because it's kind of key. And then of course this dude doesn't want to give up his source, but then Booth's like, well, okay, but then you'll have to pee in a cup and write out this form, which is going to be logged in your thing and everybody's going to know, and you're not going to go any further. Like, you're going to get cut out, you're not going to, you probably lose a scholarship, blah blah blah, like all this shit's going to happen. So he's like, of course he doesn't want to do that. This is an interesting tactic. It's like, it either piss in this cup or tell me who gives me the steroids. It's like, oh man. So anyway, I guess this guy snitched.
Yeah, he definitely does. But before we find out who he snitched about, we end up back at the lab in Cam's office. Do you want to talk about this or do you want me to go for it?
I'm gonna talk about this because we need to get through it.
It's so inappropriate. Yes,
it's inappropriate. It's uncomfortable. And just generally, why is this here? Why is this whole storyline here? It makes me just makes me kind of mad at the writers for doing this to Angela and Cam.
As the kids say today, it's cringe.
We're back at the lab and we have Angela confronting Cam about leaving this talk screen file with her to leave for HODGINS. And Angela comes in guns a-blazin'. She's ready to go on like how unprofessional Cam wants to do that. I'm not HODGINS' assistant. I'm not his secretary. Don't do that to me. And then Cam's like, okay. And then Cam starts hearing out Angela's argument that, you know, their personal life and their work life are different and they keep it separate. And, you know, you shouldn't treat me like this way or that, like where I have my job, he has his. While Cam is listening to Angela, she reaches over and picks up a CD thing and puts it into her disk drive in her computer. And she starts playing the CD. And basically, you start hearing like sex sounds, like porno. And it turns out.
We got it. CD, you didn't need to explain, but yes.
This CD is her and HODGINS having sex in the supply room.
Ugh.
And Angela walks over to the computer watching this video of her, and Cam is sitting there watching this video. There's so many things. Like, first of all, Angela walks over and sees this, and she's not even nearly as mortified as she should be. Like,
no,
this is like,
not at all.
She should be crawling into a hole in the ground. Like, she should be trying to make herself invisible in this moment because she'd be, would be absolutely.
I'd be mortified.
Devastated. I would quit on the spot and leave and not even say anything. I would just leave. I'd pack up my bags and leave.
Bye.
The fact that this is my issue, was the last scene. Cam went to Angela with the file as a resentful, passive-aggressive way to overstep a boundary and teach her a lesson. This is crazy to me. Crazy.
And it seems to be implied that this is something that she's known about for a while.
They should both be fired. This is insane. Oh, yeah.
She's like, when did they put those in the closet? When did they get that in the closet?
When did they put cameras in the closet? So then, are we to understand that Cam has this up her sleeve now? From now on, from moving forward, from this, apparently this episode, not season two, but season three, Cam has this up her sleeve so she can use it as fodder to have Angela and HODGINS under her thumb. Also, why isn't she showing this to HODGINS?
Yeah, you would think this feels very sexist.
Wouldn't everyone know about this? Like, Hodgins will know that Cam knows.
Yeah.
And the security guard. Is it our friend, the Chippendale? I wonder who saw this.
Who gave it? Because she didn't just find this out on her own. The security guard probably brought it to her. Do you think that
security guard didn't show it to literally everybody in the fucking place? Are you kidding me?
For sure.
He'd be like, hey, Pete, come here. Check this out.
Look what they're doing.
Oh, hey, Joe, come on. hey, get the popcorn. Let's have a party. Like, oh my God.
We're going to watch a movie.
Like,
oh my God. It's Cam bad. Is so it's really bad.
Satisfied. Cam is so satisfied with herself in this moment. She feels so vindicated. Angela creeps away with the CD that Cam says that's the only copy. Yeah, right. Prove it.
Sure.
And I just don't know why this is happening. This is so weird to me.
It's a weird B plot. And also, it does date this back to season two.
Yes.
Because Angela, I'm not Hodgins' assistant, Cam, but you are his girlfriend. Angela, the problem is that being his girlfriend is a personal, private thing. So they're calling her his girlfriend as opposed to his fiance or partner.
Right.
Very interesting.
It's very odd. So
it's
odd.
Very weird.
It may have been a scene from a totally different, might have been a cut scene on the floor at some other episode, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know who to talk to about it.
It's not good. It reminds me a little bit about, not the boy in the shroud, the boy in the tree?
No. Oh God, with all the teenagers. What was the episode?
Having all the teenagers sex and they're like, school. Okay, let's have a viewing party watching through all these sex tapes.
Jesus Christ.
It's like, okay. Okay. So who done it? Who's giving steroids to these boys? Well, no surprise, probably. Booth and Brennan are walking down the hall of this university. And George Francis and Colby Page are chatting about. And Booth arrests George Francis for steroids. You're under arrest for providing steroids. That's not the right word. Anyway. So he's like, what? No, he's my golden goose. I would never kill him, because he's like providing steroids and you're also going to be arrested for murder. So yeah, no, he has been giving steroids. Not so great. Seems like Colby is actually not using steroids, which would make sense because they took samples of all the kids, of all the basketball players, and it was only this one kid that was getting some other pee sample that was actually using steroids. It's not Colby. So, yeah, Mr. Francis was just trying to get him free student housing, which is nice, but he obviously was taking advantage. He was trying to... We're going to move on to find out why he was giving him steroids in a bit. And I'm not going to get ahead of myself.
You're so funny the way you do that. You're like, I'm not going to get ahead of myself. Like, you stop yourself from saying more. It's so funny. Oh yeah, God. Booth hates this guy a lot. Next we have Brendan and Cutler in the observation room next to the interrogation room at the FBI, where Booth is going to interrogate Francis. We learn that Colby, the young basketball player, is like a son to Cutler, Chief Cutler, because he's going to marry his daughter. Booth enters the observation room where Brennan and Colby are talking. And there's some discussion about how being a jock is bad. And Booth argues that Cutler would do it all over again, which Brennan finds like absolutely preposterous. Again, we're still on this line where Brennan doesn't understand sports for some reason. And then Booth and Cutler decide they're going to work together to interrogate Francis, like good cop, bad cop kind of situation. They leave the observation room and they leave Brennan behind. And Booth's like, oh, you just leave it to the jocks, okay, Brennan? Like, he's just like, this whole jock thing.
He's being so bad.
But the jock, who says that? It's like not 1982 or 85 anymore. Like, come on.
Exactly.
Okay. Well,
we're saved from that pretty quickly.
No, we're not. We're not saved because the next scene is...
We're saved because Cam and Hodgins are chatting in the next scene.
Yeah, but we're not saved because of A, the conversation. It's B, awful. We have to go forward now. This is how we have to move forward.
Yeah.
With the knowledge that Cam has seen Hodgins and Angela having sex in the supply room, and we're going to assume that Hodgins knows this because Angela and Hodgins talk to each other.
True. But hasn't talked to Hodgins, hasn't talked to Cam to tell her that he knows. Does she know that he knows? I don't know. So, okay. So he's been looking at some bugs, very helpful. And he's determined that there is blue lipstick that was found on RJ Manning's penis.
Mm-hmm.
We're not gonna cut around it or jump around it.
No, because he was being given a big blowy yes, right before he blowy. Died.
So thank you. Thank you for that.
But we get to this in a creepy way. Hodgins is being creepy, 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 gross guy. He's so creepy and gross. And this is where I ask, does Hodgins know that Cam saw a sex tape of him and Angela? No, yeah, so weird.
He's so creepy. He's like, the lipstick wasn't found on his lips. You know what I mean?
I know. Like,
yes.
Come on.
Yes, we do. Everyone knows. It's fine. And Cam, let's move on.
Her face, she's so over it. She's like, yeah, I get it. Like, Jesus Christ.
But then it gets worse.
Because it gets worse. What happens?
To Angela, looking around in her office, looking around and putting the disc in. She's putting the CD in to her computer so she can watch her sex tape at work, which is preposterous, with volume high up. And Cam walks by and is like, can you turn the fucking volume down? Are you kidding me? Angela, what is wrong with you? Like, be discreet. And she's like, she does not get the memo. She's like, you know, this is actually pretty good. Like,
oh my God,
this is pretty sexy. Like, oh, I'm feeling pretty good about this sex tape.
Oh my God.
Cam was just like, can we not? It kind of gets thrown back in Cam's face a little bit because instead of Angela being right like now, embarrassed.
Yes. I want to say, this workplace
is so unprofessional.
Is an unsafe nightmare. It is unsafe in this place. Could you imagine if you work with somebody who had like trauma from their child? Like, could you imagine dealing with somebody who actually had real trauma, like whatever kind of trauma, whether it's like a physical abuse or sexual abuse or was, you know, assaulted of some any way at all, and you work with these people
and you're having to work with someone like that who's like Hodgins, sorry, I was Hodgins, born Hodgins again,
and then Angela giving him a blowy
with
the,
some like, lip from blue lipstick.
Oh, you know what, in an HBO rendition of this show
we would see it.
There happen. Would be a scene where Angela put on that blue lipstick.
Oh yeah,
and went down on him 100%.
It would be like the end of the scene, the end of the episode.
End of the episode. Would be the Angela pulling out the lipstick, like.
Oh yeah.
Whatever, bud.
Oh my God! Them like sneaking into the supply closet, like looking up at the cameras.
Disgusting.
Anyway, so now we're getting our interrogation. George Francis is being interrogated, and this guy, until now, he showed up too much, I think, so I started to question him. But he was doing all sorts of very nice things. He was supporting the families. He was getting free scholarships for people, free housing. He was supporting these players, really, like, trying to make a difference for them.
Right.
But, yeah, no, this guy's a total... he was just taking advantage of these people, and he's a total asshole. So... He was providing steroids. Did he kill RJ Manning? No, he says he did not.
Right.
He says that he had an agreement with him that as soon as he made it to the NBA, that he was going to get all these benefits out of him effectively. And he was going to, he calls it a little return on his investment. So he justifies that he's in the right doing this, that RJ Manning was an investment to him, that he provided him cars, he provided help to his family, he provided this and that and this. And all he expected was that if he supported him and gave him steroids and made him a success, that when he made it big, that he should get to benefit from that.
Right.
Which, okay. But no. No, that's not how it should work. I mean, there's to an extent, but you should
do this all the time, though, Brittany.
Steroids and stuff. Yes, they do.
If you've ever did you watch the Michael Jordan documentary on?
I started watching it.
Yeah.
We watched, so I think we watched about half of it.
Some insight on what happens when they're at that level, of course. But yeah. This is nothing. Like, it's par for the course, I think.
Yeah.
But I just want to mention that this interrogation is happening in tandem. Like, so Booth and Cutler, Chief Cutler,
yeah,
are working together to basically get him to admit that he was dealing steroids, and if not, arrest, try to cock up some theory of him, how he and why he murdered RJ. I just want to say, at this point, this is where, I don't know if this is for you, but I was shocked knowing the truth in the ending of this episode. This scene is insane to me. Like, this whole situation.
There are two spots where I'm like,
yeah,
what?
Yeah.
This is the first one, and then there's another one coming up.
I think I know the other one too.
Yeah.
So, what was it? Cutler's theory was that RJ was going to confess to the coach about the steroids, and that's why Francis killed him.
Yes.
I just want to mention as well that I would never have allowed this to get to this point before I called my defense lawyer. I would have called my lawyer.
There are no lawyers in this at all. We had there mega lawyers in the last episode.
No lawyers. No lawyers.
No. Well, I wonder if that is because they're trying to prove that, like, they have nothing to hide, but he should definitely have had a lawyer for sure. Cutler is like totally hot-headed.
Yeah.
He's basically forced out of this room being like, if you don't arrest him for the steroid use, I'm going to blah, blah, blah. Like, whoa. He's very intense. So we'll talk about this. I think we'll circle back to this scene a little bit later, but this next scene is, again, very awkward with Cam and Brennan and Angela. So they found pre-seminal fluid.
All right. Can we just skip over the point?
Yeah.
The whole point is they're talking about blowjobs. Blowjobs, blowjobs, blowjobs. They determined that RJ was getting a blowjob and almost finished, but got absolutely bludgeoned to death. Bludgeoned to death before he could. And I'm asking.
And he got spit on.
Is this a nasty way to go, or is this heaven? Like, I don't know what the difference is, right?
Depends on how close those two things were together.
So, yeah, he gets spit on. He's getting bludgeoned to death. He's getting a blowy. There's a lot happening here.
Lots going on. And Brennan, they're like explaining every detail about how this works to Brennan, because she's like, what?
She scientifically breaks down a blowjob. It's so funny. I love it.
It's very funny. It's very cute. So we move on. We end up in a scene with Zach and Angela and Cam.
Right.
And they're trying to figure out how someone would have spit on. Wait, am I getting ahead of myself? They think that there's two people involved. So there's the victim, the murderer, and they're thinking, okay, this victim was getting a blowjob, and the person giving the blowjob couldn't have been the person doing the murdering, we think. So now they're trying to figure out, they're going back and they're realizing, okay, we got to figure out who the person giving the blowjob was, because RJ had gonorrhea. So they should be able to figure out how he got gonorrhea, and then they can figure out other things.
Right. Patient zero. They're looking for patient zero, basically.
Patient zero.
So
Because maybe that's the person giving the blowy. Perhaps.
Yes, because he's, well, because the gonorrhea, the strain of gonorrhea is the same as the guy who covered it up for the guy taking steroids. Yeah. That's what Zach points out. Is that what you, did you already say that? I'm sorry.
I did, but not in a clear way. So yes, it's very helpful.
Anyway, he just says, if you talk to this guy who has the same strain, they probably had sex with the same girl, blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? So.
So they're going to go talk to Edward Decker, the super dumb guy who had gonorrhea from the previous interrogation.
Yeah.
And this guy is too much. This this scene is too much. He is standing there naked. They go into the men's locker room at the university, Booth and Brennan. And this guy, Decker, is standing there naked. And he's like, you know what? Like, man, I can't have her in the room with me. Like, I think that she needs to, like, not be here. She's too hot. And he, like, goes on to Booth. Like, basically, they get her to leave.
I love
you,
how...
Cover your eyes or leave. It's, I mean, no, you go.
I know, it's just, the guy's so dumb.
He's so there, dumb.
Like... And Brennan's like, how did this guy get into college? Like, she just doesn't know how all these people got into college.
Sports. Sports is how. Oh my God. He's so dumb. He's like, look at my penis. I have nothing to be ashamed of. I have nothing to be nervous about. Yeah. Look at it. But also, like, please leave because you're too hot. He's such a douche. Anyway, but in a funny way. So he can't concentrate. So either Brennan has to leave or she has to cover her eyes because, and Booth is supporting this. But anyway, they need to get down to the bottom of this. So I guess they're just going to let it happen. So Booth talks to this Decker guy, and it turns out that this guy likes to have sex with lots of people. He usually uses a condom, except that one time he didn't use a condom with a girl who he calls not hot, who was not hot. And this is when we find out that Brennan has been listening the entire time.
She
never left. She suddenly somehow gets her, like, the top half of her body above the locker and is like, are you for real that after this whole situation, that was your big takeaway? That you had that poor thing, poor you, you had sex with a not hot girl. Like, give me a fucking break, man. Like, wow. Who cares? Anyway, but they give her name, which is very helpful. It's his poli sci tutor, Justine, who we will recognize from early days of this episode.
Yeah, she's at the beginning of the episode. She's the one who discovered the remains.
Yeah. So we're going to go talk to her. And the thinking here is that he wasn't just going around having sex with people, giving gonorrhea to everyone. She would have given it to him. And hopefully he's responsible enough to not go give it to other people. But anyway, that's...
Who, the guy from the shower? Is that what you're talking about? Yeah. Anyway, so they have to go talk to Justine, who's the poli sci tutor that she had sex with. The naked dude, I think his name is Eddie, the one in the locker room, as well.
Yeah, Eddie
as
Decker.
RJ, the victim. So Booth wants to know where Justine got the infection, because they're interviewing her about everything, and she's well aware of her STI status, which she's being treated for. Brennan cannot believe she doesn't wear a condom all the time, then states that Justine isn't smart at all and that the university is terrible for having so many dumb students. Brennan, like, I can't believe she went to university not being aware that there are dumb students.
Dumb people that not get everyone gets A+.
Because their parents pay, or they get a sports scholarship, and they're not very academic. Anyway, then Booth asks her if she wears blue lipstick. Justine admits to having sex with Ed Decker and giving him gonorrhea on purpose, because it turns out that RJ is the one that gave it to her. And she was committing revenge by giving it to Ed Decker to prove that to RJ that she existed, because she felt like RJ treated her like shit after they had sex.
Okay, I just need to say something. That is illegal.
Oh yeah, I never thought of that.
That is super illegal.
Yeah, but it probably happens all the time with young people.
Oh, yeah. Anyway, so...
yeah, well, there was that guy who went around giving it HIV to people, remember? That guy?
Yeah. Well, I guess if you're going to get something, gonorrhea, can you...
Gonorrhea is treatable.
It's treatable. At least, whereas if you get HIV, that's not so good.
Oh, it's treatable now. Like, back though, it wasn't.
Yeah.
Oh, people have been living... It's treated like a... Especially since COVID, actually. But before that, people were on all kinds of different medications.
Oh, like antivirals and stuff.
Antivirals, true. Exactly. And then now with COVID, seems to have advanced HIV research quite a lot, actually.
Oh, yeah, because of the mRNA. I do remember reading about this.
Yes, you're very smart.
I mean, I remember words sometimes.
Anyway, Booth and Brennan ask Justine for some DNA. They're basically accusing her of killing RJ. She's crying. Yeah. Crying, and she's using a napkin to wipe her tears and snot and stuff. And then she gives them the napkin, and she goes, here, take it. Like, take my snot, take my tears. And then she rips out this huge tuft of hair out of her head. Hair. So violent.
That's like how much hair I have on my whole head.
Like, she gave the fucking hair to them and ran away. And I was like, where are the lawyers? Where are the liars? These kids, I agree with Brennan that these children are dumb.
They're so dumb.
Just giving away all their DNA. It's crazy.
No problem. Well, I guess all these people have nothing to, they think they have nothing to hide because they're like, I didn't do it. Just take it. So anyway.
What if your DNA is found like 20 years later somewhere and
that's
like
true.
It pops up because it's like,
you do
oh,
commit a crime.
There was this murder way back in the day and we took your DNA. Like, do they have a record of that? Like, oh, we took it because you were a suspect? That's weird.
I think they probably do. Is they anyway. Find, yeah, for sure they would because they have all these cold cases lately. There have been some resolutions on them because of that.
No, but I mean, like, so they kept your DNA stuff. Do they keep it or they destroy it if you're determined, like, innocent? You know what I mean?
Well, if you're innocent,
or do they keep it on file?
I would think they would still keep it on file, but maybe they're not.
So much wrong with this. Okay, now what's the next scene, darling?
Okay, I think the purpose of this next scene, so Cam is talking to Angela.
Back at the lab.
And they determine that that it's not just any blue lipstick, that they're talking about the blue lipstick, and it's not just any blue lipstick that they found. The specific blue lipstick is actually used by the college cheering squad for the Atlantic State Jaguars, who is the cheerleading squad for the university we've been at this whole time. So I would have thought it would be obvious. I don't know why we need a whole scene for this, but that was the conclusion. So sure enough, they show up to cheerleading practice where they're all in their full uniform.
No, but the way they shot the scene, I want to ask the director, is this supposed to be sexy because they're wearing their cheerleading outfits? They're like, look, but I'm telling you, this routine they're doing is so lackluster and not interesting at all.
That's what I wrote. Like, I was like, do these actors even know how to cheer?
And I'm also like, they're all wearing blue lipstick, and this blue lipstick, Brittany, is so hideous.
It's so ugly.
So awful.
It would match.
Don't ever Amy's... make me wear blue lipstick. Awful.
It would match Amy's blue eyeshadow from a few episodes ago, though.
Oh my god, this is terrible.
So. All the cheerleaders, Cutler walks in with this warrant, and suddenly all the cheerleaders look so nervous. Like, I don't know why. And so they end up swabbing.
They knew they were
coming.
They knew they were coming.
I guess so. But so they
had to put on
all
their
uniforms. Yeah, exactly. They had to look presentable. They needed to show off the routine. So they end up swabbing all these girls. They have them in this big line. And Booth and Brennan are standing.
They're back at the lab. They all
no, not yet.
No, they took all the cheerleaders to the lab to get tested. They're in line.
I thought
at
that
the
they're
lab.
Standing. It's at the lab.
gonna show this to you. So go on. I thought
it was in the gym. I watched this episode so many times.
That's why you're so mixed up.
My attention to detail is like not good. Okay, so anyway, so they must be back at the lab. So they're all lined up, getting their mouth swabbed, and at the very back of the line is Dallas. Miss Attitude Problem, although Kelly loves her, so we're gonna just let, she's probably gonna be her her king of the lab. So she tells Brennan and Booth straight up, like, yeah, I knew that he was cheating on me. I honestly didn't care because at the end of the day, he was coming home to me and I was going to support him from going from his being a person who lives in an apartment who he can't afford and is getting paid for him to living in a mansion with him because he's an NBA star. That is my long-term plan. That was my long-term plan. And then she starts crying. Oh yeah, that's definitely the lab. Okay.
That's not
ignore
the
me.
Gym. That's the lab.
Yeah, that's the lab for sure. So they're in this line. They're talking to her. And she starts crying. She gets teary and turns away from them because she's saying that she would have had this giant mansion that he would have gotten if he was in the NBA, blah, blah, blah. Anyway,
okay.
Brennan turns to Booth and she's like,
no.
Okay, wait, is she crying because she loved him or is it for the mansion?
No, no.
And Booth is like, Booth mouths the mansion.
No, no, no.
She knows what she wants, I guess.
Listen, I'm going to tell this story from my perspective because you just heard Brittany's.
My perspective gonna rewind? Is, give me a break.
Now we rewind, we go, rewind. They're at the lab. They're all getting swabbed for DNA. RJ's girlfriend's last in line. Booth and Brennan saunter up to her and ask if she knows why this is happening. The girlfriend says she's well aware of why this is happening. This is where I said, I love RJ's girlfriend. I think I love her. She's so pragmatic. And she figures out that Booth wants to drum up. She said, oh, I suppose your theory is that I was this incredibly jealous person and I wanted to kill him because he was, you know, having a go at all these women, right? And then she explains to them that she knew exactly what she was getting when she started dating this guy. And she had no expectations of fidelity. All she wanted was the future. She wanted the future. She said, I'll take the shitty apartment and the dorm room or whatever, but I also want this. Like, this is, she was very driven and ambitious that way. My favorite line she says to them, she says, RJ liked girls, all kinds of girls. I'm just one kind. I just thought that was like, wow. And then Brennan asks her what kind of girl she is. And she says, I'm the permanent kind. I'm the permanent kind. And I just thought that was really cool. There's a couple of good lines here. There's another one later, but.
Mm-hmm. Oh, she's self-assured.
She's very, I liked her. I thought she knew exactly what she was getting. She was like, you know what? This is it. Like, I don't know. There's part of me finds this very, okay, oh, we all don't all marry for love, you know? And it doesn't mean that she didn't love him. Like, come on. Like, she just knew who he was and just let him do what he needed to do for himself. That's kind of an interesting...
That's an interesting dynamic.
I don't know. like, to each their own. And the fact that Booth says that she wanted the mansion, this makes me like a little bit like, okay, Booth. It's like,
but she did.
Like, well, sure. She earned it though. This is a business. Like, marriage is a business. It's a business proposition. When you get into, I mean, okay, I love you, blah, blah, blah. Here's our agreement, whatever. In terms of monogamy, blah, blah, blah. Fine. But I just think it's, marriage is business. Like, you have to invest in each other. And I just think it's interesting. I thought she was very strong.
That's true. At this point, they're just boyfriend and girlfriend too.
Like, they're not, there's no, they're young, blah, 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 all that stuff. Like, what if she wanted the house? She wanted stability. She wants something good. Like, she wants to have children and she wants to raise them this certain way. And like, you know what I mean? Like, whatever. This whole idea is that there is such a thing as what are, like, there's a whole discussion these days about gold diggers, right? Like, about women that are gold diggers. But I'm like, and there have been arguments that say that that is a misogynist term, that gold digging is, women have had to suffer like so much, or like we've had to accept and tolerate and compromise so much to a point where, yeah, give me the fucking house.
Give me like the gold.
Don't mess around. Like, I'm doing this, you know, this is our agreement. You know what I mean? I don't know. I just feel like it's really derogatory when they say it about women. Mm-hmm. But nobody says anything about the man who expects the woman to tolerate and compromise and do all this stuff for them for nothing.
Yeah.
No, not well, for nothing.
Zach and Brennan are completely on board with you because we end up back in the exam room. Zach has finished reconstructing the skull. And Brennan mentions to him, she's like, she made the decision, this Dallas girl made the decision to hang on to him, let him have sex with other women. And Zach is like, actually, this sounds very rational, this lady's thinking. And Brennan is like perplexed because she agrees that it's very rational. Her thinking was very rational.
Yeah.
We find out here very quickly what the murder weapon is. And the murder weapon is a free weight. It had, they, fortunately for us, the person who murdered this victim hit the victim exactly in the right angle to leave the imprint of the 25 pound symbol from the free weights in his skull. So they're able to go straight to the fitness room at the university. And they look at the 25 pound free weights. Sure enough, there's blood on them. So they for sure have their murder weapon. So, what about the saliva and the loogie, as they call it? The spit. So, two things. The saliva, did not come from the same person as the person who spit on RJ Manning. So the person giving the blowjob was not the person spitting on him. Who was the person giving the blowjob, Kelly? Because holy shit.
I was trying send you a photograph of something, but I can't do it right now. So hold on. Where are we? Oh, okay. So
we're going to identify the blowjob giver.
Do we identify the blowjob giver at this point?
We do. Cam has it on her screen and turns it around. A picture of
Celeste Cutler.
Yes. Boom, 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 boom. Miss. What was the word? What were the words that her boyfriend used for her? She's very, very loyal.
Very loyal. Yeah, exactly. Very loyal. But already gone to the gym to look at the weights and the blood and all that stuff?
Yes. We went to the gym.
Yeah, so I just want to mention the weights. While I was looking for this photograph, because I was excited to see our friend Greenman, our lab tech from the FBI. Yeah. And we forgot to mention at the beginning of this episode that Agent Charlie was with us.
Yes.
Agent Charlie and Greenman, two recurring. I love it. I love it so much. I see them. It makes me happy.
It's nice to have these recurring extras.
I agree.
I feel like they add a nice element of consistency, not having completely different people all the time.
All right. So now, after all this stuff.
Yes.
Next, we have Celeste and Colby in the interrogation room at the FBI. They're holding hands. Brennan is swabbing Colby's mouth. Now, this is an interesting device the director used. I'll bring it up in a bit, but they're holding hands. And the theory is that Colby killed RJ because he caught Celeste giving him a blowy.
I mean, it's a good theory.
It's not bad.
It's a pretty good theory.
A tangent they went on about how they set him up, like they did it on purpose, like so that he could kill him and get his job or whatever. Yeah. Regardless, while this is happening, Cam knocks on the door and interrupts them with some urgent evidence. Then Booth stands up and he's like giving the Colby and Celeste a stern look.
And Colby's no longer holding Celeste's hand at this point, by the way.
Well, this is where...
As soon as the news of Celeste blowing some other dude comes up, he's like, I'm not holding
your hand. Yeah, he stops holding her hand after it's revealed. Oh, that it is revealed to Colby that Celeste was giving RJ a big blowy.
Yeah.
And is being accused of it. And Brennan is so... I love her. She's just like, well, it seems that she was performing oral sex. And then Colby's like, Jesus Christ. You're finding out like this guy's dead. This is happening. Then your girlfriend's cheating on you. You're like, what the hell is going on here? Anyway, this is when Cam interrupts. And that's right. You're right. And it seems that with the saliva they found, this big loogie they found, there was a CODIS hit, which is this database. I guess they have for people. I thought CODIS was just people who are criminals.
I think it's people who've been, I think it's all people in the law enforcement realm. So I think it includes law enforcement agents.
Makes
as
sense.
Well.
Yeah, it makes yeah. sense. So that's,
and I'm sure like the secretaries and whatever, like
everybody
that works there.
Has to do these tests. So they're put into this database. Yeah. So that's good. So next, Booth cannot believe this, his eyes when he looks at this file. And of course, it's revealed to us in the next scene. Booth and Brennan arrive back at the gym. And our friend Chief Cutler is sitting in the bleachers all by himself, wearing his uniform. Booth and Brennan walk in. They start having a talk with him. Cutler basically sings like a canary and tells us Celeste doesn't know it was him because she ran away when she heard somebody come in while it was happening. Like, Celeste has given him the blowy. Look at me, blowy. And then
the blowy.
And she hears a noise. She hears a noise like, hey, girl there. And she runs away. And then Cutler was mad because he thought RJ was a scumbag. He knew somehow that RJ had gonorrhea. I don't know how that's possible.
Throughout this investigation, it comes up, but I guess he would have known it before. That was part of his motivation. I don't know. Or it's just something that came up.
This is weird to me. I find it a little bit extreme to kill someone because your daughter's giving them a blowjob. Like,
yeah.
I just feel like, okay, like... It's not really your business, guy. Like, it's
I think maybe he was drinking as well.
I don't know where the drinking is. Or is that where the booze? You're talking about the booze.
I think he must have been drinking because the booze, like he pours all that booze on him, right?
But that's so strange. The booze is out of left field though, isn't it?
Unless it was an attempt to hide or cover up the real reason. Maybe he thought that if he had this booze on his body, then they would think that he was drunk. I don't know.
I just want to say, Cutler, at this point, it's revealed that he has a gun. And Booth tells Brennan to leave. He's like, you have to leave now. Brennan has a gun. You don't have one. You got to get out of here. Cutler wants to kill himself.
Yeah.
Booth pulls his gun and tries to talk him off the ledge by mentioning his basketball stats and how great he was in freaking college 25 years ago
before he ruined his career because he got an injury.
But like, who does that? It's like, Brittany,
he doesn't have sensitivity training.
Brittany, don't kill yourself. Remember when you used to run marathons and
you were like so fit.
You were like 20 years younger.
You
were 25 years younger. Like, but why does it have, what does it have to do with now? I killed a guy. Like, Jesus. It's like, remember, Kelly, when your ass was an inch higher than it is now? Yeah. So.
Yeah, I do. Thanks for that.
It doesn't help at all.
It makes me feel worse, actually, Booth.
You're making me feel worse about my life choices.
Well, thank God Brennan was dismissed because she doesn't listen, obviously. And when she goes out of the room, she ends up sneaking back in over by the bleachers. And just as Cutler is about to shoot himself in the head with this cop gun, she sticks her finger or hand in, like, the back. It pinches her hand, the back that would have. Anyway, I don't know how guns work, but it stopped it from shooting. It stopped it's it from the- shooting, and it hurt her hand, and it was bleeding. And anyway, Booth was able to apprehend him. She was able to take the gun away. They worked well as a team. The firing pin, I think it's called.
I don't know. It's like with a cocking thing where you cock the gun. So she stuck her finger there, so it stopped it from squeezing, like from firing.
So it couldn't shoot properly.
And
which would probably be super dangerous when she actually removed her hand.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry, but that is so, like, the fact that the gun did not go off and it was like, oh, sorry, I'm dropping shit. The fact that the gun didn't go off and nobody died.
Yeah, oh yeah. It's a miracle.
If that was today, it would have totally been a disaster.
No, it would not have worked. But he'd be dead. All is good. He is now going to be a cop in prison.
Oh,
so that's good.
He's not a cop, though. He's just a campus policeman. He's not a real cop.
He wasn't a real cop?
No, he's a campus policeman.
Yeah, true.
It's not the same.
Which actually, campus police chief, why would he have been in CODIS?
I don't know. That's the thing. That's a good point. I don't know about any of this.
I kept thinking that he was a cop. But no, you're right. He's campus police.
I guess we can ask.
Well, Booth and Brennan are going to end this episode at the Royal Diner, which is super cute.
The culprit was apprehended and the crisis was averted. And now where are we?
And now we're at the Royal Diner, not Wong Fu's. That's so season one.
I know.
And it's sweet. They're having this cute conversation. And Brennan is like, you know what? I was saying all along about all these basketball things and sports things and blah, blah, blah. But you know what, Booth? You're actually a good guy. You're a man. You don't take these games too seriously. You're a warrior. And I know, Brittany, that you are a good guy.
I'm going to stop you. I'm going to stop you right now. I know you're tired, but I'm not letting you do this.
No, it is. No, I don't think.
This is nice.
Okay. It is nice, but.
Booth, let me.
Okay, Booth, you go.
It's still mad that she calls Jock stunted adolescents.
Yes.
Even though they just closed a case, they ate a whole meal together, like literally are finishing a meal. So why aren't they talking about this an hour ago? Anyway.
It's awkward.
She said, no, I never met you, Booth. I never met you. And he says, well, I'm one of those guys. She's like, no, you're not. Here's another good line. Like you said earlier, you don't play at being a warrior. You are a warrior every day. And you definitely are a fully developed man. And then he kind of shyly goes, okay. And then she goes, you know what? Even Cutler knew that you were lying when you said you treated women the way you did back in the day. And he's like, what do you mean? Like, that's no way he'd believe that. And she's like, Booth doesn't believe her. And then she points out that because Booth remembered the full name of the girl that he fooled around with under the bleachers meant that he didn't treat women poorly for some reason. Like, this somehow translated to her that because he remembered her, it was
that he didn't just like screw and dispose of these women. Yeah,
exactly.
I'm underplaying it because this is very season two. It's sweet. Yes. But it doesn't have that same sexual tension. Like, they're not talking super close. They're not holding hands. They're not like, it's very clear that this episode, it ends the way it started. It's very clear this episode was not filmed in the same time period as the other episodes. So, especially if you keep watching and let it like end the credits and go straight into the next episode, they look completely different. Like, they don't even look the same. It's weird. Anyway, what did you think?
It was wacky. The whole thing, I felt like, wow, what's going on here? like you said, with the dynamic between Booth and Brennan, the whole Cam Angela Hodgins situation, Zach being fully engaged, it was very oddly placed. I want to know, like, from someone, there has to be something somewhere that says what happened here, because it's it's very strange, A, that it didn't air last season, B, that they would put it here. It's very odd.
How often that happens, though, that they do film.
Well, I know
they'll film scenes that they don't include.
I know they also shoot episodes out of order. Like, I know that sometimes, like, one might air at a different time, blah, blah, blah. Like, but not the same, like, different seasons, I don't think. I've never heard of that. Yeah. Like,
no, I haven't either.
Maybe you're right. Maybe it's common, but this is so out of place. Given that last week was the first episode, well, given that last week was the first episode back after the strike, and then, like, so much time has passed since they filmed this episode.
I wonder if it's, if they were expecting the strike to happen, so they wanted to have, like, a couple episodes in the bank. I have no idea. It is most curious, and I look forward to...
No one expects a Spanish Inquisition.
We have four more episodes of the season, and then that's
wild.
It.
Wild, wild, wild. Mm-hmm. That's wild.
It's crazy.
Kings and rats.
The rats are the literal rats.
Kings and rats. Kings and rats. Kings and rats. Is that what you want to do? Yeah?
I'm just kidding. But yeah, let's go with it. The rats are the literal rats at the beginning of this episode. That birthed its three babies inside a dead human body. Anyway, but also Celeste. Honestly, fuck her. Oh. She's horrible.
Wow. Why Celeste?
She's horrible. She's like pretending to this guy that they're engaged. Like, she's like, I'm so in love with this guy. We're so close. I don't like Brennan. I don't like the way she's talking about you. Blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, we find out that she was screwing around.
Also, what is the scene where you thought it was insane that Cutler was involved, considering he killed...
Oh, sorry. Yes. When he comes into the cheerleading practice to give the warrant to figure out whose blue lipstick it was.
Like... To go through this whole case, to
when he
follow
knows
along,
that it's his daughter,
knowing that his daughter is the one, knowing that he killed the guy, knowing, like, that's like, and then this whole killing himself doesn't add up. Like, the way he's all depressed,
it was so
kill
extreme. Yeah.
I'm just like, well, but you were basically a sociopath the whole time, like a psycho who, like, went along and interrogated people.
And then suddenly, now that the gig's up,
now you have
now
remorse?
It's like, oh,
yeah, okay.
No.
Okay.
I don't think he had any remorse.
Celeste.
I don't think he had remorse. I think that he was feeling sorry for himself, and he was sad that he got caught.
Who's your king?
Wait, who's your rat?
I had to think about this.
Okay.
Angela.
Yeah. She's so skeezy in this episode.
She should be fired without any kind of severance package the way she behaved.
She's terrible.
Like, that stuff is like, that's brutal.
Oh yeah. It's not good. But, you know, you win some, you lose some.
Angela's my rat. Who's your king?
Okay, I think maybe it's Colby.
Yes!
Ding, is that ding, your king ding, too? Ding, ding.
Totally.
He showed so much respect.
I love Colby!
I loved his character. I love the way he was like, listen, I'm not going to replace RJ Manning. I'm not trying to replace him. I'm a team player.
Wanted to hug him and go, it's okay.
I know.
And, like, take him out for, like, breakfast and, like, tell me what your dreams are. Like, maybe he wanted to be, like, an accountant or something. He didn't want to play basketball, you know?
But he just did it so he could have a scholarship, so he could put himself through school.
Yes, so he could have a future. And then he was like going to have a family. It was going to be all nice. I just like, aw, so nice.
He's so sweet. I feel like, can we have a special mention? He's not a king of the lab, but like, thank you to Zach for being season two, Zach. I missed you. Season three, Zach is a train wreck.
Yeah, I was going to say Dallas as my king because I really liked her. But I decided on Colby was my first instinct. But Dallas, I liked her because she was just very, so sure of herself. Very confident. She was
very sure of herself.
And she had no illusions, which is a nice thing in a young woman. She wasn't, she's very pragmatic, like I said.
So. I wonder what percentage of these wives of...
Oh, honey, come on.
Probably a large percentage.
Come on.
The wives of these football players, basketball players, etc.
There's no way. It's like this whole thing with David Beckham and Victoria, right? Like,
yeah.
Come on. Like, these guys are multimillionaires. They're drop dead gorgeous. All those guys, like, especially on basketball teams, they're going to strip clubs. They're going to Vegas. Oh, yeah. They're going here. They're going there. They're fucking around. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And it's like, in more ways than one. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's just a lifestyle. And it doesn't, like, mean anything. They just go pick up. Look at Kobe Bryant, for God's sake. Like, pick up. But, you know, they have the wife and kids at home, and they're taken care of. And the women have their own lives. Like, they have friends, and they have stuff they do, and they have...
And they have the Real Housewives, the shows.
Whatever.
The various cities.
Sure. Of course.
Yeah. It's interesting. Honestly, this episode, if it had aired in season two, I think I would have really liked it.
Yeah,
in season three, it was just out of place. I still liked it, but it was just very out of place. I don't know what they would have replaced or what they would have switched it out for. So
we've gotten nowhere with Booth and Brennan. Like, it's a complete bottle episode that's just on its own.
Yeah.
With no forward momentum at all. I mean, it had nothing to do with like any of the case, like the Gormagon case or anything too, right? So it's so out of place.
The Gormagon case is like the overarching theme of this season, but we've barely had any episodes with it.
When so does it's it very get solved? Interesting. Does it get solved next season, I guess?
The very last episode of this season.
It gets solved.
Kind of.
Okay.
Not fully. Like,
don't. Okay.
Like,
ish. I don't want to know.
There is some level of resolution.
How's the next episode? Is it okay? I see there's a baby in the title.
Next episode's pretty good, actually. It's pretty funny.
Funny with a dead baby?
The baby is not dead.
Oh my God.
It's just in a tree. So.
Oh my God. Okay, on that note.
It's pretty good.
On that note, thank you everybody for joining us for this episode of
Squintcast.
I'll just mention before we close, go to our Instagram, like, follow, subscribe, do all that stuff. Help us out. Tell your friends. Listen. Thank you for being here. We love you. We adore you. Send us an email. Check it out in our show notes. I have the email address there. And follow us, like I said, on Instagram and stuff. We love our social media. And thanks again. See you next time. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you for listening to Squintcast with me, Kelly Booth, and my and your new friend, Brittany Elsner. The Bones theme is performed by The Crystal Method. They can be found on Instagram and YouTube at The Crystal Method and at thecrystalmethod.com. Intro and outro music is by Twisterium at Pixabay. Cover art was done by Irena Dolenc-Stajan. You can find us on Instagram and TikTok at Squintcast. Email us at squintcastpodcast@gmail.com. You can find me at fab_empire_ on Instagram and TikTok. Brittany is at Brittany81523 on Instagram. See you next time.
HODGINS!